Number 20 on our countdown. We can go to one collection. We talk about the Gateway Collection. And kind of an interesting duo, interesting pair. Where Winchester started and the most popular Winchester production rifle of all time. Let's start up front, lot number 15. It's a first model Henry rifle. It's serial number 1441. This is a Hoxton engraved, silver plated first model Henry. And it's up there. I mean, it's in the top 1 or 2% of engraved silver plated guns that we've ever sold in terms of rarity. Just going up front and on the silver, we talk about how silver can darken and tone, and it's just starting to take on that beautiful black aged patina right on the top of the frame, but kind of a deluxe Hoxton pattern. Normally you see the running deer. That's very typical for the Hoxton guns. This is a more deluxe scroll and vine pattern, and the condition's absolutely out of sight. First model, and actually you'll see the block rear sight on some special guns in that first model range. And I mean, even I think the first 10 guns, I don't believe they have a rear sight. So a special gun, factory engraved, silver plated Hoxton engraved Henry from the Gateway Collection. And then right behind it, we'll go to lot number 1021. So the gun that got Winchester started and the gun that carried Winchester from the 19th century to the 20th century, the Winchester 1894, the most widely produced, manufactured Henry lever action rifle. And this gun is also special, again, from the Gateway Collection, but a factory engraved 1894. The letter's about that long, noting the special order features on this gun. But not only is it deluxe wood, but it's carved. So it's carved F. That was the order number, carved F, that you'll see in the highly finished arms catalog. And then the pattern is a number 9 pattern. So a factory engraved, factory carved Winchester 1894. It's a takedown, half mag. I'll flip it so you can see the panel scene on the other side. So we have the single deer, and then we have the other side, kind of the same thing with the running deer. But it's condition. So carved wood, but then look at the case hardening on the lever, case hardening on the hammer. Just a mountain of a gun, truly is, for a factory engraved Winchester, brought to you by the wonderful Gateway Collection. Number 15, number 1021 in your catalogs, number 20 on our list. Number 19 on the countdown, and I probably should elaborate a little bit more, probably should have, but if this grouping doesn't show you what this auction's all about, I don't know what does. And I think the countdown's done a good job of demonstrating how great, how potent it is. Essentially a continuation from the June sale. If you guys paid attention, I know you did, how great that sale was. Not in terms of results, which was great, but in terms of what we were offering. And again, this September 11th, 12th, and 13th, this is a continuation of that. And on this table, we have the tip of the spear of the Gerald Klaas collection, that is his Volcanic collection. He has sub-collections within his general collection, and his Volcanic's the finest group ever assembled. And there's four lots on this table, but there's another 6 or 7 behind it, including, you know, a 6-inch number 2 Smith. It's endless. And so let me bounce around here and show you a few things, and I'll concentrate on a couple. Right here, lot number 11, you can see it's a 10 for the number 2 cartridge. But it's not just a 10 that is also about brand new, but it's a complete 10, a 10 of 200 rocket ball cartridges, Volcanic cartridges. find another set like that. Speaking of unique, we've sold, I believe, 4 or 5 Volcanic pistol carbines, what they refer to these as. This is lot number 1011, by the way. Never had one with a scope, and that's what we have here. So in just terms of overall coolness, how do you beat this? And for rarity, it gets no better. It really gets no better. But the two I really want to focus on are right here, and I'll start with lot number 12. Okay, so this is lot number 12, and how often do you get the opportunity to have two pistol carbines? But they look different, and they are different. That's because this is a Smith & Wesson pistol carbine. Now, they said they manufactured 6. I challenge that. I don't know where that number comes from. There are 2 known. So if they did 6, there's only 2 known, and this one absolutely smokes the other one, wipes the floor with it. And if you remember the Smith & Wesson experimental carbine, the genesis of the lever action rifle, we had that in the last sale. This is its little brother. This is its mate, if you will. It came out of the same collection, so this gun was maintained by the Wesson family. I should pick it up rather than just point at it. This was maintained by the Wesson family. It was sold to Abercrombie & Fitch in the 1970s. It was purchased by Al Kelly, and that name will come up, or excuse me, Al Kelly, Al Kelly, K-E-L-L-Y. And then it was sold to Calhoun Norton, and Calhoun Norton sold it to Mr. Klaas, along with the Smith & Wesson carbine. And they're very much the same. They're in terms of engraving, in terms of embellishment. I'll flip it around so you can see it. So if you can picture the carbine that we had in the last auction, same scenario, deluxe piano rosewood stock and grips, engraved on the barrel, engraved on the frame. They say six were manufactured. It's only one of two known. It's a mountain of a gun for what it is. Really the genesis of, we talked about that, the carbine being the genesis of the lever action, and that's right behind it. Now, in front of me we have, this is an interesting set for a number of different reasons. This is lot number 1005. These are the Smith & Wesson number one, call them what you want, lever action magazine pistols, bag grips, Volcanics. There's a number of different nomenclatures and names for the number one Smiths. And this is a very, very, very interesting set. Of course, I think everything on this table is photographed in the Volcanic book. So well pedigreed. Now this set, being a student of the marketplace as a whole, it explains another set of guns. There's a very famous set of Colt Dragoons. They're nicknamed the Van Cycle Dragoons. And there was quite a bit of litigation surrounding the Van Cycle Dragoons, and that, were they Colts or were they not Colts? They clearly weren't embellished by Colts. So what we have here is a set of guns, the set of number ones, and they were remodeled. That's the term that's used by the retailer, and it's right here on the barrel on this number one, but it says remodeled by Andrew Werflin, Philadelphia, and this is about 1855. So he would have bought these guns and embellished them. He made the grips, and he did the exact same thing with those Van Cycle Dragoons. Everyone's been wondering who did it, or it has to be Andrew Werflin, not just for the different embellishments, but also for the case, and we can dive into that later. But I want to pick this gun up and spin it and show it to you guys, because it's condition. They brown the barrels, they engrave the barrels, they case harden various components and parts. You can see the blue here on the top of the frame, but the overall level of embellishment is rather deluxe. How deep, rich, and profuse it is, and the full coverage nature on both pairs. So I'll open this up, and I just want to show you guys the case so you can see it. So if you're familiar with the Van Cycle Dragoons or you want to look them up, you'll notice tremendous amounts of similarities in the casing itself. In the hinges, look at the hinges, look at the overall aesthetics of it. Now this set was actually put together by Dr. Klaas. When it was discovered, there was, I believe, just one pistol with the set, and then noted collector and dealer Tom Lewis actually found the other pistol. So Dr. Klaas just had the one gun, and he was able to reunite the pair. There's a presentation here on the right grip stock that I forgot to mention. But you also see that on the Van Cycle Dragoons, that same gold on the grip itself. So a wonderful grouping of Volcanics, and this isn't all of them. So if you're a Volcanic collector, a Winchester collector, a Smith collector, look some more, dig some more. You'll find approximately 10 more Volcanics throughout the sale. Just the tip of the spear, dive into some of the rare ones, the cooler ones, neater ones featured in the sale. Number 19 on our list. Number 18 on the countdown. It's getting more exciting, hopefully for you. It certainly is for me, just great gun after great gun after great gun after great gun. I'm excited to talk about these. I told you earlier you're gonna get sick of hearing me saying Gustav Young and Nimschke, and you probably are by now, but it doesn't matter because we have two incredible rarities presented here in the sale. I'm having a hard time picking out which one I want to discuss first. I'm gonna start with the American. Okay, so this is gonna be lot number 214. And you don't hear Gustave Young, factory Gustave Young, and then the next, which is gold inlaid. And that's what we have here. Gold is good. That's the conventional wisdom in 19th century American fine arms collecting. Gold is always good, particularly as it relates to factory engraving, because it's so rare. It's the highest level of embellishment that you could use on a firearm. And most of the gold guns were reserved for exhibition pieces, which is exactly what we have here in this American. So the serial number on this American is 15689. That is 15689. All right. Where to start? So this gun appears, well, let's just roll it and I'll show you the work on it. And we can see Gustave Young's own hand, the finest 19th century American engraver, again, cutting American firearms that ever lived. And I'll roll it here so we can see the other side. He did the frame, the cylinder, the barrel at the muzzle here, and then his signature dog head here on the top of the grip strap, which is my favorite part of this gun. Just a huge, gigantic gold animal head on the top of the grip strap. So now let's talk about the gun a little bit. This gun appears on a list and correspondence from Smith & Wesson to M.W. Robinson. Now Robinson was Smith's largest distributor. So this gun originally shipped, and I'll get back to the list, this gun originally shipped in the early 1870s. And like I said, the gold inlaid stuff was reserved primarily for exhibition. So this gun first shipped to Austria in 1873, and it would go on to be displayed at the Austrian World Fair. It would go on to be displayed at the very famous 1876 Centennial Exhibition in Philadelphia. And then in an unidentified fair in 1877 in San Francisco. And how do we know all this? So Parsons' seminal work on Smith & Wesson, where he actually went into the factory archive, and his foreword to his book says, there is not a more complete factory archive from a 19th century firearms manufacturer than Smith & Wesson. They kept meticulous records. And it can be difficult to get those records now, but luckily we have this in Parsons' book. This comes off of page 130, and the correspondence states that Smith & Wesson was trying to sell off some of these highly embellished arms, and they gave them to M.W. Robinson, and essentially they listed the price on the list of how much the guns cost to produce and manufacture, and they pretty much told them, get the best price that you can. So this is one of three Gustave Young gold inlaid Americans, and it's kind of the missing gun. It was always known about, but not where it was or anything. And here it is, and it was in Dr. Klaz's collection. And this gun's listed by serial number 15689 on that list from Smith & Wesson to M.W. Robinson. The other gold inlaid gun is on that list. It's in the 7,000 range, I believe, 7,400 or 7,500 range. And this gun was listed as a cost of $70, and the other one was listed at a cost of $75. And the difference being that this is ivory grips and the other gun's pearl grips, and pearl was a slight premium. So this gun cost Smith & Wesson $70 to manufacture and engrave. And then it traveled the world at all these various exhibitions, and again engraved by the finest 19th century American engraver to ever do it, Gustave Young. Gold is good. It gets no rarer. Again, it's the highest level of embellishment that could be bestowed on a gun during that time, and pretty much still is. Now, right next to it is a Smith & Wesson first model third issue. Also, and I'll pull it off the stand so we can really see it. Again, gold is good. Gustave Young, factory engraved, factory gold inlaid. So we've sold one. We had a Tiffany 44DA that went to the 1893 Columbian Exhibition. We sold that. That was out of Bill Goddard's collection. We sold that 7-8 years ago. This is the third factory gold inlaid Smith & Wesson that we've had that I can recall. But it's a panel seam gun. You'll see a panel seam here on the left side, and I'll flip it again. You see a panel seam here again on the right side of a gentleman shooting. It's good to get the scale, and you can see the size of work that Mr. Young had to work with, and then you can see the talent that he actually had when it comes to how great that scroll is, how fine that scroll is on these metal surfaces between the small 22 caliber tip-up and the larger 44 American. Two exceptional Smith & Wessons. They're both factory engraved, factory gold inlaid, by Gustave Young, number 18 on our list, lot number 214 and 215 respectively. Number 17 on the countdown is lot number 213, so it'll be sold on Friday. That's 213. And again, we're talking about a gun coming out of the Dr. Gerald Klaas collection. And where to start? You know, it just looking at, if you're unfamiliar with the 22 tip-ups, the Smith & Wessons, I got no other word, but it's kind of a pipsqueak of a gun. I mean, it really is. It looks unassuming, just a small pipsqueak of a 22 caliber revolver. And it could not be further from the truth on what this gun is and what this gun represents. My passion originated from antique Smith & Wessons. This is the first. And just in their name, so this is the Smith & Wesson. It's the first model, first issue, first variation. We as Smith & Wesson collectors call them the first. So it's the first revolver manufactured by Smith & Wesson for mass production. And they made six variations. So you have the first, second, all the way up through first, sixth. And as manufacturers, we talk about gun manufacturers being pragmatic. What worked, what didn't work, that's what those iterations represent. Changes, make it better, make it different, make it work better. So let's go back here. So the inventor by the name of Roland White, he actually worked for Colt, 1853-1854. Roland White had patented the bored through cylinder. And this is like revolutionary for firearms manufacturing. The bored through cylinder to fire the self-contained metallic cartridge. So we had some Volcanics earlier. It's a self-contained cartridge, a primitive self-contained cartridge, but we're talking about the 22, the rimfire, the actual rimfire with a casing, propellant, and bullet. And Colt passed. Colt passed on the patent. They were not interested in it. And that is a seminal moment in American manufacturing, in the American Civil War, in American life. Because what would happen is that Roland White would go on and work and contract with Smith & Wesson under a royalty agreement where he would get 25 cents per revolver manufactured. And so Smith & Wesson has entered into an agreement with Roland White to be the sole manufacturers of revolvers with the bored through cylinder capable of firing the self-contained metallic cartridge. And what does that mean? That means throughout the American Civil War, Smith & Wesson's the only one producing, and probably for our benefit, these revolvers. You had the first through the sixth. You had the 1 1/2s. Old model, new model. You have the number 2 Army, and the number 2s are, you know, 32 caliber rim fires. Had that not been the case, we would have had essentially Colt producing much larger calibers of the self-contained metallic cartridge during the American Civil War. And knowing firearms manufacturing history, it's a fascinating story to read. Roland White's patent, he filed for an extension. It would not go through. And you have Colt producing the single action. Well, you have the 1871 open top in 1871, and you have the various conversions. And then, of course, you have the 1873 Colt single action revolver after Roland White was unable to get his patent extended. And again, a seminal moment for American manufacturing. And so this little revolver is serial number 5. It's the earliest known. It's the earliest known revolver, again using Roland White's patent of the bored through cylinder to fire the self-contained metallic cartridge. This is out of the William Lock collection originally, and then it went to the Dr. Klaas collection. Now Smith & Wesson, they say they only manufactured approximately 214 of the first. There's only a little over 200 that were manufactured clearly. The issue they were having is the small recoil shield that they were using and the pin they kept developing. Essentially, almost all the first are different when you have the ability to examine one, and there's very, very few known. So while it might be a small, as I said, pipsqueak of a revolver, it's a mountain of a gun in terms of manufacturing importance in American manufacturing history, more or less. So here's an opportunity to own the earliest known, again, bored through cylinder, capable of firing a self-contained metallic cartridge. Serial number 5, Smith & Wesson, first. Number 17 on our list, number 213 in your catalogs. Number 16 on our countdown, we are going to talk about a collection rather than an individual piece. And I realize that I'm kind of cheating in doing that. But I always say this is my favorite gun in the sale, I have to tell you, this is one of my favorite collections that we've ever cataloged because it's just so damn cool. And I have no other words for it than that. And our approach to selling this, you have to have a vision to sell a collection like this. You have to have a vision, of course, to put together a collection like this. And so in thinking about it, thinking about what it means to collect fine and historical arms, particularly 19th century American firearms, we ask you to apply this one philosophy and this one concept, which is that no other collecting discipline as a whole connects you to the past like fine firearms, like firearms do. And what do I mean by that? And that these are absolutely tangible pieces of American history, particularly of the epic that is the American West, the conquering of the American West, westward expansion, manifest destiny. It's all here within that collection. Now, Mr. Fox had a lifelong love affair with the American West, with Big Sky Country, with Montana, and that is the totality of the collection. But it's not just limited to Sharps rifles or percussion Colts. It's the idea of working guns of the West, and then it's reinforced by truly exceptional benchmark examples of these guns. And so I don't really have anywhere where to start in particular, but I want to show off the diversity. And what do I mean when I say apply that notion that firearms are the finest tool that can absolutely take us back in time, like the DeLorean in Back to the Future? Let's take a look at this Buffalo Sharps and its imperfections, its scars are its beauty. And that's the really neat thing. And so what do I mean? Well, here's a classic Montana shipped Sharps Buffalo rifle. Nothing pretty about it, but it's authentic as it gets. And I want to show you the forearm because this is what really gets me. The first time I held this gun, it gave me chills. But you can see that it's actually worn down the hand imprint from a lifetime spent in the hand and a lifetime spent in the saddle of being in the field, in the range, used to hunt, used to protect, used to fight. You can actually see that and hold that, and it takes you back 150 years. I mean, you can taste the dirt in your mouth and the sweat on your neck when you hold this gun in your hands. And that's what this collection does. These are authentic working guns of the American West. I mean, right in front of it, if you're looking for mint examples, those guns were not there. Here we have a conversion of a Springfield trapdoor, but again, it's its scars that make it so wonderful. And I'll pick it up here. This is again one of my favorite pieces in the collection itself. look at the period repair buffalo hide, more than likely underneath here. That's a field made set trigger. Look at the front sight. The front sight is made of bone. It's a bone front sight. And then it's kind of the same story as the Sharps, but look at the wear. Look at the wear here. You can't duplicate that. That's earned. You can't duplicate or forge it. These are very much working guns. And so we have a Wyoming shipped Froin Sharps, again, another iconic Buffalo rifle, but with Froin sights. We have the Crow Killer, Winchester 1876, owned by Montana icon Liver-Eating Johnson. And his story's absolutely epic. As it goes, his crows had killed his wife and his newborn son. And so he set out and supposedly had killed somewhere between 200 and 300 crow braves. And it was said that he would eat their livers. And that is what it is. That's Robert Redford's character, Jeremiah Johnson's based on his exploits. Here's his gun. We have serial number 22 Colt single action. Again, it's nothing pretty. It's a rim fire. It was converted to center fire and then converted back to rim fire. But you tell me that gun wasn't there. It's serial number 222. It's got the coin 1876 front sight. And that's just real, honest, authentic, been there, done that. Where? That's what it is. But then right in front of it, here's the duality that is the collection. We have a beautiful first generation single action shipped to Ed McGivern, and it's absolutely mint. We have a Texas shipped Lightning, factory engraved Texas shipped Lightning with carved steer head pearl grips, a factory engraved first generation black powder single action. We have a beautiful pair of silver plated 1861 Navy revolvers with wonderful checkered ivory grips. And just, there's about 120 pieces in the collection in this sale, and we have a few of them on the table. This is the contrast that is the John Fox collection. It's so much fun. It's so wonderful. We hope you enjoy. We kind of did a special layout in the catalog to try and show off what these guns mean, and to be able to have the opportunity to catalog a collection like this. We're selling it in 2 days. So it'll be sold on Friday and Saturday. And we kind of approach it as like a one owner sale situation where normally we break it up Winchesters, Colts, Civil War, US military, you get the idea. We're selling this collection as a whole, and we're calling it a celebration of the American West. Again, this could just as easily be number one on my list because you can sell mint guns, you can sell rare guns, but these are that. It takes a lot for a gun to be both old and mint. But it also takes a lot for a gun to be authentic and been there and used and appreciated and passed down and appreciated. So here we have, again, the John Fox collection, a celebration of the American West, number 16. Number 15 in our countdowns, lot number 440. We have a Steyr 98K BNZ sniper rifle. Now, I mentioned, we talked about that the VG2 earlier in the countdown, and I said it came out of a really old time collection that was put together 30 or 40 years ago. This gun is also part of that same collection, so you can see the quality that it represents. One of the finer World War II German sniper rifles we've ever had, without question. It's an all matching gun. The condition is as issued. When we say that, very rarely, but it is an as issued gun because it is exceptional in overall condition. And to complement it, I mean, just as a gun for what it is, again, it's one of the best we've ever had. And I think the GI take home case takes it to a whole nother level. And the fact that the case remained with the gun after the GI sent it home. And of course, the World War II as a collecting genre has exploded and will continue to explode, especially when you talk about sniper rifles, trench guns, of course the 1911s, but for a World War II German sniper rifle, this 98K BNZ is as good as it gets with great U.S. history as a take-home souvenir, a war trophy, call it what you want. It's number 15 on our list, number 440 in your catalogs. Number 14, lot number 262. And we've mentioned a few of them and we'll do some more, but we're in the high art European field. And we don't get to be there very often, especially when we're talking 16th century Wheellocks. And that's what we have here, courtesy of the Robert M. Lee collection. To have a true pair, it's hard to articulate the rarity that is. And these are what we call them a few different things. Ball pommel, squash butt, and you'll even hear puffer mentioned. And while they're not quite puffers, what they say is they have the puffer architecture. But these date to the last quarter of the 16th century. They are Saxon Wheellocks, reference the Saxon Royal Armories in Dresden. And these things are incredibly well pedigreed, but before we get into that, I would like to roll them and show off the workmanship that is done on this fabulous pair. So it's fruit wood and inlaid with bone, particularly red stag. very difficult to do these any justice with photography and even video. You have to really hold them and to experience them. But you can see the level of inlay and how difficult and how ornate they really are. I'll flip it around so you can see the ball or the squash butt pommel, and it's obvious why they call them such. And these, see the inlays are, they're cut deep. It's a very deep cut for the inlay to take. Perhaps the most important factor about these guns is their pedigree. So when they were sold in 1973 or 1974 out of the William Renwick collection, who put together one of the seminal collections of high art European firearms as well as some others, the pedigree was that they came out of the Hermitage Museum in St. Petersburg, Russia. And of course, as I said, they were sold in 1973 or 1974 by Sotheby's when they did those seminal sales of the Renwick collection. They've also been owned by Peter Talou, Eric Volley, and of course, they come to us courtesy of the Robert M. Lee collection. These were also on loan to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in 1931 and were included in one of their displays. So these are ancient guns, but their exhibition history is almost ancient. I mean, you're talking almost 90 years of pedigree of exhibition and ownership. So in terms of workmanship, they get no better. In terms of historic pedigree, they get no better. It's the finest pair of Wheellocks that we've ever offered. Again, they could just as easily be number one on the list, but they're number 14 and number 262 in your catalogs. Number 13 on our countdown, we have lot number 1387, and it is one lot number, and they're being sold as a trio. These come to us courtesy of the legendary Robert M. Lee collection, the distinction being part of his high art sporting gun collection, and they very much are high art. And what we have is a trio of best quality Evo Fabry, Pinless Sidelock, Ejector shotguns, and these are by master Bellino engraver Torcoli. And I can shut up and let the photos and the video do the execution on these shotguns justice, because they are exquisite. It's what we call, and what they call, I should say, what they call a fantasy engraving, and for obvious reasons. But the execution is absolutely phenomenal. Again, they're being sold as a trio. There's no really reason to pick them up. It's hard to pick up that light, and maybe we'll pan to some photos or something else. But when we say they're spectacular, I'm just trying to roll it here so you can see why. But the execution is just absolutely out of this world. They really get no better for Torcoli work, his Bellino work, as good as any. Again, lot number 1387, number 13 on our list. Number 12 on our list, we have our first cover guns. These guns are photographed on the cover, I believe, of volume 3 of this premier auction. September 11, 12, 13. Our first cover guns that we'll talk about in the top 50 countdown, and believe me, we'll talk about all of them. And these guns are cover guns for obvious reasons. They are absolutely spectacular. They are mates, they are twins. They're as good as they get for exhibition pieces by the hand of Louis D. Nimschke. Starting with lot number 53, we'll talk about the rifle first. And you know, really there isn't a whole lot to talk about. It's better off to show. And the Evans, I don't want to say experimental, but not a widely produced rifle. They're a little awkward looking, but they're absolutely spectacular for in terms of embellishment. And these are exhibition pieces. So I'm rolling this one. I'm gonna turn it so you can see the presentation on the other side here. And look at the work here. Again, this is Nimschke at his finest. These are both documented in the pull book, Nimschke's pull book. So I'll set this one down, and we could examine the musket a little bit here. This to me, I like this gun. It's hard to compare them. Obviously, rifle, octagon, musket, full nickel. I like the scene on this one just a little bit better, but it's hard to say one is better than the other, and they should actually be probably kept together. One of these comes courtesy of the Robert M. Lee collection, and the other one an anonymous collection. But let me roll that so you can see it. And again, you can see why they are cover guns, because for high art firearms, for level embellishment, they really get no finer. And it's also price point. I've touched on it a little bit in some of the previous videos, but these are price point guns. And not to say that $35,000 is an insane amount of money, it really is. But when we talk about collecting and investment quality stuff, these are best quality guns by LD Nimschke. And when you look at Winchester, say, by Nimschke, they won't bring the same amount. So here's your opportunity to put something on the wall that is the best of the best, really the best of the best, and the price points are great. And that's why I do think antique and collectible firearms are so undervalued when you look at the artistic merit, the execution, the pedigree as exhibition guns that they are. But here they are, cover guns of volume 3, number 12 on our list, lot number 53 and lot number 55. Number 11 on our countdown is lot number 1487, and this is part of the NFA Class 3 offering. This is a Chinese Type 64, and while it might not be the most aesthetically pleasing, sexy firearm there is, it is incredibly rare, absolutely incredibly rare. I can say without fear of contradiction, we've never had one, and it's probably a one of one to own. This is, of course, the integrally suppressed 22. This comes out of the Mitchell Werbel collection. And again, we did a video specifically on Werbel's guns, and this one's got a pretty unique history, and it's very well written about. Again, Ryan Sullivan, one of our specialists, did a total video on all the Werbel guns. Really, really unique, really interesting. But this gun is so well documented. Say, how did Werbel get this gun? Well, when he was over, I believe, in Vietnam, there was an attempted assassination attempt on his life with this gun, and he explains how he negotiated and relieved his attempted assassin of this pistol, and here it is. So an incredibly rare Type 64 Chinese integrally suppressed 22 semi-automatic pistol, lot number 1487, and it's number 11 on our list.